Today I'm going to cover how to make a QEV valve or a quick exhaust valve out of one of these long sprinkler valves. There's a lot of instructions on how to do them, but they've changed a little bit, and I want to show you a slightly different way to do that. This one is a Rainbird 1-inch, model number CP100, and I'm going to show you a couple of variations on this one that make it a little difficult to do what the other instructions that you might find will tell you to do. A lot of it remains the same. You're going to take this solenoid off. Most people will tell you throw it away. I'm going to keep it. It might be good in another project. This one has a purge valve. We're going to glue that in there so it doesn't do anything crazy. The key difference between these and the other ones you'll find out there, the older ones have a lot of meat here, so you can get a threaded insert in there. This one doesn't. There's probably no more than a quarter inch, and actually that would be generous. So I'm gonna do this a slightly different way. What I'm gonna do is we're gonna use a PVC cat. We're gonna put the threaded insert in here, and then we're gonna seal this up and put the trigger on here. So again, this is a little different, but I think it fits better and is a little bit safer for the newer style ones that don't have a lot of meat. In terms of being able to drill and tap a hole in there. Put this back in the position that it was. It's keyed. And if you make note of this, you'll see there's a little vent in there, and that's for this side. Which we're gonna plug that up anyway. So let's get those screws out of the way. First thing I'm gonna do is drill a hole in this, tap it, put a threaded insert in there for the air gun release, and then we're gonna do a few little things that are way different than what you've seen so far. We'll make sure this is in place, and I'll get started with getting this cap ready. This is the insert we'll be using. It's a common air fitting. You can find it at Lowe's or Home Depot. A half inch drill will give me enough meat left on the plastic to get this threaded in there. So I've got a half inch drill bit on the press. It's really a mill, but got a nice hole drilled in there. There's about a quarter inch of meat. You may be able to see that. So I'm going to be pretty comfortable. This tap is slightly smaller for the half inch, but it is getting in there and giving me a start of a thread. And I didn't realize I didn't have a tap for a half inch hole, but that's okay.
Wrench, or spanner, as the Brits would call it. Get this started.
Here's the fitting, and there's probably about an eighth of an inch, maybe a little bit more sticking out. I'll clean up the glue that's in there, and what I'll do is I'll put epoxy around that just as insurance. That's what I've done before, and these things seem to hold up pretty well when they're done that way. So I'm going to clean it up and get some epoxy in there, and then I'll show you what the next steps are going to be. But we're going to have to let the epoxy dry, so we'll probably let this sit overnight, and I'll finish the build on this quick exhaust valve tomorrow. I've got some 5-minute epoxy, a tray that I used to mix it up, an old junk screwdriver, and I'm going to fill that little gap up. Well, maybe. with epoxy. And this is what it looks like. Let's get a downward shot. If you can see that, there's epoxy in there, almost to the edge of the brass fitting. And once that sets, we'll go on with the next phase, getting that that trigger set up and running, or the QEV valve. So I've got this piece glued up, and came out nice and neat. Looks pretty clean inside. See if I can give you a close-up. It might be hard to see that, but there's a good epoxy coating in there. This isn't going anywhere. There's a few more things that have to happen to make this valve work correctly. Now, in the videos that you've seen, they have you plug up every little hole that's in there. That's not what we're going to do. Let me show you what exactly we're... So all the instructions that are out there to date will have you do two things. They'll have you plug this hole. Hope you see if you guys can see that, this hole right here. And then this little hole. I'm going to plug this hole. This one we're going to open up a little bit. And I'll show you why. First thing we're going to do is get some epoxy in here. We're going to remove this. Get some epoxy on that thread and close up that hole. Actually, I'm just going to pour epoxy in that little hole right there. I want to seal that off. And let me go ahead and start doing that. That little hole in the middle, I'm going to drill that out just a little bit so that the epoxy has something to hold on to. And I'm going to put a little bit of tape on the bottom of this. I don't want epoxy leaking into the air chamber, so... Let me go ahead and get that done and get these things epoxied, and you'll see. We'll see how this works out. I'm going to put a little bit of tape over that hole. I just don't want epoxy leaking into that chamber. Probably should put some over here, too. I'm going to drill that out just a little bit. And a little bit of a broader base. You can see that I've opened up that hole just a little bit. I did a quick test of this, and it actually works really well, thankfully. The ended up drilling a larger bore hole, probably around 5/16. You may be able to see it. You may be able to see it deep in there. You can see there. So I'm not worried about having to drill through the plug, but the problem I'm encountering is that the... plug itself leaks. There's apparently not enough thread in there to accommodate or provide a good seal. So I'm going to solve that with the good old standoff or standby. Let me get this off of here for right now. I'm going to epoxy this thing in. And one of the things you want to make sure, of course, is that you don't have any leftover Teflon thread in there. I've already gone through this plug. And what I'm going to do is mix up some epoxy, get it on the threads, get this in here as much as possible, and then I'm going to do an epoxy pour around this whole thing. And hopefully that'll seal it up good enough to give us a good seal and go along with our quick exhaust valve. But it does work, and it works great. I think it'll work. We're going to let that set and get some of that extra epoxy off. My stuff may not look perfectly, but if I can help it, I at least want it to look halfway decent. So the epoxy's dried. I've got everything together. This is the setup I did for the final configuration. I've got a test air chamber that is airtight, and I think it's time to test this. I'm going to fire up the compressor, get about 100 psi in there, and see what happens. All right, I've got the compressor charged up. Let's put a 100 psi. This unit's rated for 150 according to the manual, but I plan on shooting anything anywhere from 80 to 100. All right, we're at 100 psi there. And here it goes. This should fire away here. 3, 2, 1. I would say that that trigger works successfully. I don't have a barrel set up yet, but we'll be doing that next. And the first thing I'm going to do is actually create a bait launcher for the beach that'll shoot up slugs of ice loaded with bait hook sinker. Anyway, it's been a pleasure. Hope you've enjoyed and I've gotten something out of this. Again, this was for the Rainbird CP100. How to modify that without creating a dangerous situation. I will say one thing. Compressed air and PVC can be dangerous. If you're going to do anything with it, use Schedule 40. My advice would be to over-engineer, not under. But anything you do with PVC can hurt you or even kill you. So with compressed air. So if you do anything, do it at your own risk, but please be careful.